This peaceful English village, with its 14th century church, has made history. History in sportsmanship. The words you so often hear on English lips, "That's not cricket," might have had no meaning, but for the high standard of rules which originated in this village of Hambledon, nearly 200 years ago. Here is the first cricket field, broad halfpenny down, the scene of many a match in bygone days, where from small beginnings the first hard and fast rules and traditions of cricket were born. Today, members of the Hambledon Cricket Club, watched by their families and friends, carry on the traditions of this democratic game laid down by their famous ancestors. Traditions which have spread from this little Hampshire village to all parts of the world. In fact, to wherever the English language is spoken. It's even spread to the fair sex, wearing the trousers, as usual. And it's good training for the youngsters too, because besides being a national institution, it teaches them self-control. Talking of training, you can see the real thing when the Gloucestershire County Club are practicing at the nets. Hard work this, but it's well worthwhile, because in cricket, as in almost everything else, practice makes perfect. It looks as if they spotted someone. Yes, it's Walter Hammond, England's captain and master of the game. Since he first played for his county, Gloucestershire, in 1920, he's become one of the greatest all-round cricketers in the world. Wally chooses his bat very carefully, feeling it for balance and weight, a vital factor when it comes to making those superb strokes of his. Yes, even Hammond has to practice. Look at that for style. I wouldn't like to be in the way of one of those powerful drives. Of course, they're only a sample of what he can do when he really gets going out on the field. Well, here we are at Lord's Cricket Ground on a typical English summer's day. These two spectators firmly believe in the old saying, if you take an umbrella, it won't rain. Oh no. Wally Hammond has been playing cricket too long to be daunted by the English weather. Do you think there'll be any play before lunch? No. Well, while we're waiting for the sun to come out, let's turn back the pages of cricketing history and see how it all began. It's generally believed that cricket began many hundreds of years ago amongst the shepherd boys in the Weald of Kent, who struck the balls with their cricks, or in other words, with the twisted end of their crooks, hence the name cricket. The stumps were probably tree stumps. So now you know the origin of the words. The first wicket was not pitched until about 1673. It was about half the height of that used today, and the bat was more like a hockey stick, because you see, the batsman had to hit an underarm ball which travelled very low along the ground. By the 18th century, the days of the famous Hambledon Club, cricket was becoming fashionable. The stumps had grown and the bat had changed as well. The higher wicket marked the beginning of the overarm ball, considered so dangerous at first that players were forbidden to raise the arm higher than the shoulder. So now you see how cricket has changed in the last two centuries. Funny, Harrovian hats never seem to change. Most of you know that cricket bats are made from these English willows. They're not the weeping variety, which you find screening the occupants of a punt, but the Salix alba caerulea. The felling is usually done during the winter months, because if it's left until the sap rises, the wood doesn't dry out so well. A tree takes from 12 to 15 years to grow. Incidentally, the average weight of a bat is about 2 pounds 5 ounces, and they're sometimes made to measure, like a suit of clothes. Here we see them marking and splitting the clefts, which are the shape of things to come, so to speak. The average number of clefts from a tree is 36. I wonder how many cricket bats they'll get out of this lorry load of clefts. Perhaps that new bat you want is amongst them. Anyway, this village is where they make them, and they've been doing so ever since 1876, for famous players all over the world. The great W.G. Grace used one of their bats when he made his 100th century in 1894, and 1,000 runs in the month of May a year later. Now it's time to saw the cleft. If you watch, you'll see the rough outline of the bat appearing. But that's as far as they can go for the time being, because the next process is a lengthy business. The blades are wheeled out into the yard and stacked into the open for about 12 months. At the end of this time, they're seasoned and ready to be taken back into the factory and made into cricket bats. Here's a pile of seasoned blades, which means the moisture has dried out of the wood, making the blade tougher, and incidentally several pounds lighter in weight. Let's follow them into the sawmills. Here the blade gets a little more treatment in the way of accurate shaping up. First of all, it's cut to the right length. When the face of the bat has been shaped and cleaned up, it's put in this press, which imposes a pressure of about 2 tons to the square inch on the face, case hardening it so that it'll stand up to the impact of a fast ball. So you see, the bat's face needs just as much care and attention as the girlfriend's does. The back of the blade gets as much attention as the face, because it affects the whole feel and balance of the bat. And this is very important, especially to Walter Hammond, on an occasion like this. Yes, that's right, it's Lord's again, and the rain has cleared away after all. And it looks as if England's captain is set for yet another century. By the way, did you know that Lord's was named after Thomas Lord, who acquired it at the end of the 18th century, and not because the ground was frequented by the aristocracy? Oh, lovely shot. That was a beautiful off-drive, which would sting his hands, but for a rubber shock absorber in the handle of the bat. Here's one being fitted. The handle is made from lengths of cane, glued together into what they call slips. There are three of these, with the rubber in between. Fascinating, isn't it? As you can see, the handle is still very much in the rough, and before it's finally shaped, it's put into a cramp and dried under pressure. Yes, that's the cramp. When it's dry, it doesn't take many seconds to make this shapeless handle into the real thing. Just watch it appearing. Here's a handle being glued into the blade. After it's glued up, it's left for about 24 hours to dry, and by that time it's as firm as the proverbial rock. It just won't come out, which is as well, because it has to stand up to Walter Hammond's most powerful drives. When Hammond hits out, it's hard to believe that the handle is only held in place by glue, isn't it? Another important feature of the bat is balance. This is obtained in the shaping, and it's done almost entirely by eye and feel. Very highly skilled work indeed. The back of the bat is now due for still more attention, and here you see it being finally shaped. What fun this man must have given grown-ups and boys alike. Some would say his life is to be envied. Now the bat is ready for glass papering, but the balance can still be ruined, and that might make just the difference between one of Hammond's superb off-drives to the boundary and a single, which brings us back again to Lord's, where England's captain has already had a wonderful innings before a big crowd. Let's have another look at that stroke off the back foot, this time in slow motion. Watch the ease of his movements. Yes, cricket is a peaceful national game, which awakens memories in the hearts of Englishmen wherever they may be. Yet the game is not without its thrills, especially when Walter Hammond is in. Watch this beautiful stroke. And that's where we must leave Hammond, settling down to another of his famous centuries. And that's cricket, born amongst the shepherds in the Kentish Wealds, and developed in the fields of Sussex, where even today, as we've seen, willows are still felled, and master craftsmen shape the bats as in days gone by. So you see, the rules laid down in this village of Hambledon have penetrated to the four corners of the world. To Australia, to New Zealand, to South Africa, and to India. But for the men of Hambledon and their shepherd boys, cricket might never have become our national game, nor would the famous phrase, "That's not cricket," have become known throughout the world.